Good evening to all.
Good evening, madam.
I'm Dr. Padma Gunaratna, President, Sri Lanka Medical Association. We are at the beginning of the webinar to be organized by the expert committees, Sri Lanka Medical Association, Expert Committee on Women's Health. The webinar would be on facets of gender, journey towards development. I'm very glad the chairperson, Professor Sampatha Gunawardena, and her team took an interest in organizing this, the most needed and the up-to-date topic for which I was with sort of a fairly personal interest. As women, there is so much that we could be happy and be satisfied of, but at the same time, there is so much that we need to gain for women in general. So I think that based on all these things, needs, they have, I mean, having considered all these, that they have organized an array of the speakers. I mean, by looking at the team, that I could imagine that they all are sort of well-known, established figures, so that I know that it's going to be an excellent webinar. So before they start it, let me introduce you to moderators. So the moderator, main moderator is Professor Sampatha Gunawardena, chairperson, Expert Committee on Women's Health, Prof in Community Medicine, Faculty of Medicine Science, Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayawardenepura. And also Dr. Amanthi Bandusena, Consultant Community Physician, Health Promotion Bureau, Unit Head Policy, Advocacy and Risk Communication, Ministry of Health. So let me very warmly invite these two speakers to moderate the event. And also on behalf of the Council of the Sri Lanka Medical Association, let me warmly welcome all of you for the webinar on facets of gender, journey towards development. Over to you, Sampatha.
Thank you, madam. Firstly, I would like to thank the President SLMA and the Council for giving the Expert Committee on Women's Health the opportunity to conduct this webinar titled Facets of Gender, Journey Towards Development. Sri Lanka at present has good health indicators, which we are very proud of. And often, many countries quote especially a maternal mortality ratio, which is lowest in the Asian region. However, despite this, gender inequality remains a major barrier to human development. Girls and women have many major strides since 1990, but they have not yet gained gender equity. In order to achieve gender equality, women at all levels need to be empowered. In Sri Lanka, some healthcare providers do not perceive gender inequality as an issue. Hence, the Expert Committee on Women's Health thought of this topic to enlighten you on this important area in addressing women towards development. Before I introduce the speakers for this evening, we would like to share with you a short video to refresh the meanings of the terminology that will be spoken of several times during the presentation. So sit back and relax. Vihanga, you can show the first video.
What's in a name under the umbrella of sexuality? Sexuality is diverse, deeply personal, and includes many parts. It is how people experience and express themselves as sexual beings. It includes sex, gender, gender identity and roles, sexual orientation, sexual experiences, thoughts, ideas, fantasies, how we experience intimacy, touch, love, compassion, joy and sorrow, which are expressed in the way we speak, smile, stand, sit, dress, dance, laugh and even cry. Sex is one's biological status, as either male or female and is assigned at birth. It is in fact determined by chromosomes and associated with physical attributes such as hormone prevalence as well as external and internal anatomy. It is therefore clear that sex cannot be decided according to one's own wish. A person's internal psychological sense of being male or female, or neither or both, is called the gender identity, which can be the same as or different from one's sex assigned at birth. Transgender, on the other hand, is a term given to those whose gender identity and expression do not conform to the norms and expectations traditionally associated with their sex at birth. Sexual orientation is an enduring pattern of romantic or sexual attraction to persons of either the opposite, the same, or both sexes. The attraction to the opposite sex is known as heterosexuality, while attraction to the same sex is termed homosexuality. Bisexuality is therefore the term given to the attraction to both sexes. The gender identity and sexual orientation are thus two different entities. The socially constructed roles, behavior norms, and attributes for male and female is referred to as gender and often vary from society to society, evolving with time and laws, where the resources for men and women that can be accessed jointly or separately are often decided by the society. Gender roles are the attitudes and behaviors considered acceptable and expected from people according to their actual or perceived gender identity. Gender stereotyping is defined as overgeneralization of characteristics, differences, and attributes of a certain group based on their gender. Gender discrimination is when there is a bias based on a person's sex that leads to defining the roles he or she should play in society. Gender-based violence is the violence perpetrated against someone because of their gender. Gender equality is when people of all genders have equal rights, responsibilities, and opportunities, whereas gender equity is the process of being fair to women and men. Sexual health is a state of physical, mental, and social well-being in relation to sexuality. It requires a positive and respectful approach to sexuality and sexual relationships, as well as the possibility of having pleasurable and safe sexual experiences free of coercion, discrimination, and violence. Sexual autonomy is described as person's liberty to determine when, with whom, and under what circumstances they engage in sexual activity. Sexual rights are part of human rights and recognized in many national laws and international human rights documents. It is free of coercion, discrimination, and violence, giving access to knowledge and services while enjoying and respecting the bodily integrity, choosing a partner, and deciding to be sexually active.
Thank you very much, Vihanga. I would like to now introduce to you the first speaker, Dr. Janaki Vidhanapathirana. Dr. Janaki Vidhanapathirana is a specialist in community medicine and presently working as a director, National Cancer Control Program, Ministry of Health. Prior to that, she worked in the National STD AIDS Control Program and was involved in many sexual and reproductive health programs for more than 15 years. Her constant, unwavering efforts in areas of HIV/AIDS prevention and gender equity build the capacity of many sectors, including destigmatizing marginalized and discriminated populations. She was the president of the College of Community Physicians of Sri Lanka for the year 2018-2019. Dr. Vidhanapathirana is involved in many research collaborations, both in national and international level. She has several publications in index journals and presentations on sexual and reproductive field in both local and international conferences. Over to you, Janaki.
Thank you, Sampratha. Good evening to everybody, President, distinguished delegates. First of all, I would like to give a very short description about Sustainable Development Goals. The United Nations has adopted Sustainable Development Goals to achieve 17 goals and 169 targets to improve the quality of each person's life with no one left behind by 2030. Each goal is dependent on other goals and they are universal and integrated. Goal 5 addresses the gender equity and goal 3 addresses good health and well-being. Goal 3 is central to all 17 goals and if it is not achieved, the implementation of all other goals will be compromised. Madam President, distinguished delegates, this evening I wish to emphasize in my presentation the connection between Goal 5 and Goal 3 with relevance to the Sri Lankan situation under the topic of reaching equal health, a gender perspective. What is universal health coverage? All individuals and communities receiving the health services that they need without suffering financial hardship by 2030 is termed universal health coverage. Gender equity is at the cornerstone of the UHC, where no one needs to be left behind. Now I would like to draw your attention to the gender gap index. It is calculated based on the data on economy, education, health, political empowerment. The Sri Lanka Gender Gap Index holds the 116th position out of the 152 countries and accounts for 67, while Ireland and Finland being the highest with 89% and 86% respectively. It is clear that Sri Lanka needs a further 33% to close the gender gap. When considered in the overall picture, males have a high mortality while females show high morbidity. Biological sex difference as well as the gender inequity are two of the main reasons for that. Gender inequity leads to negative outcomes, especially for females and favor of men in many societies. Since the female have more life expectancy, the social isolation and the poverty among females leading to economic independence at later stage is more common. Gender is one of the social determinants of health. It is embedded in other social determinants like education and poverty, which influences health outcomes and access to health services. Although many laws and policies in the country promote the better health outcome, there are few restrictive laws like 365A and Vagrants Ordinance leading to a reduced access to healthcare services and hindering the provision of services in key population groups. This is further aggravated by negative attitudes of the service providers. When gender inequity exists, the negative health outcome for women than men would be more. Tellies. This chart shows global and regional pooled disability adjusted life years for 359 diseases. Delhi is the one way of measuring the disease burden of diseases by summing up the years of life lost due to premature mortality and the years of lived with disability. You can see the Delhi figure of the female is more than male in the Southeast Asian region. Contraceptive is an investment. This chart shows the global and regional pooled disability adjusted life years for 359 diseases. Delhi is one, sorry, investment is provision of contraceptive yield, social and economic returns, and reduced maternal and infant mortality. A health survey 2019 revealed that the contraceptive prevalence rate among women aged 15 to 49 was 65% in Sri Lanka and was the highest level in the region. But it was only 43% among the currently married women 15 to 19 age group and was equal to the lowest level in the region. Sri Lanka needs to pay attention to improve the situation of young married women. Family planning not only protects the women from unwanted pregnancies and potential life-threatening complication, but it also allowed women much greater access to educational and employment opportunities. The unmet need of family planning was 6% in 2018. Teenage pregnancies. Sri Lanka shows the lowest total fertility rate in the region, and it was 2.2 in 2016. A significant number of teenage pregnancies occur each year, which is around the range of 18,000 to 24,000 per year. The purple bar shows the static percentage of teenage pregnancies each year, ranging from 4.2 to 4.1 during the last 3 years. Line chart shows the fertility rate of young women aged 15 to 19 who gave birth or pregnant with their first child. This is also a static picture, with a 31% adolescent pregnancy rate in 1975 and 32% in year 2016. There is no difference during the last four decades. These data indicate that urgent investment is necessary to reduce the percentage of teenage pregnancies because it gives rise to negative outcome for both mother and the baby. Abortion rights. Every year, 250,000 women undergo illegal abortions in Sri Lanka. WHO has recommended that abortion should be done by balancing the medical reasons and the women's right to protect the autonomy of their bodies. Although Sri Lankan laws allow right to the highest attainable standard of well-being, abortion is only permitted to serve the life of women. Social barriers to accessing contraceptives for unmarried young people leave a disproportionate impact. The criminalization of abortion may serve to solidify stigma associated with sexual activity among young people. The evidence shows that legal restrictions to abortion do not reduce abortion rate. The situation causes women to turn to illicit abortion, which often results in increased maternal morbidity and mortality. Presently, next revision of the Sri Lankan abortion law is approved by the cabinet, and the parliament approval was withheld due to religious barriers. Maternal mortality ratio. Gender inequity plays a significant contribution for maternal mortality ratio. It is 29.2 per 100,000 population in 2019. Sri Lanka is aiming for a single digit number. Abortion is one of the single significant direct cause, which is important to reduce the unmet need of family planning. The maternal suicide also contribute to the maternal mortality ratio in the recent years, and it is also relevant to the gender inequity. Work parity. First drop shows reduction of maternal mortality with increased work parity. That means female representation in national workforce reduce the maternal mortality. At the same time, when work parity increases, both male and female life expectancy increase. Child health. This graph shows the increased child wasting, stunting, low birth weight, and child mortality with the increased gender inequality. Female genital mutilation. The female genital mutilation is an extreme form of discrimination and violation of the human rights, which reflects inequity between the sexes. It causes decreased pleasure, pain during intercourse with reduced orgasm in long term, apart from the short-term complications like bleeding and infection. This practice is carried out in Sri Lanka among young girls of a specific ethnic group to a large extent in a silent manner. The Ministry of Health has issued a circular prohibiting female genital mutilation by medical professionals. A study carried out by Dr. Isha Vijayavadana, one of community medicine postgraduate trainee in 2019, revealed that the prevalence of female genital mutilation among the 16 to 49 years old ever married Muslim women in the Putlam district was 92% and 91% among their daughters. further legal changes need to be done to protect young girls. LGBTQ population. LGBTQ population have a higher risk of substance use, sexual transmitted diseases, bullying and rejection, anxiety, depression and suicide as compared to others. This is due to gender inequality and restrictive laws in the country leading to higher risk of acquiring HIV too. It is high time to repeal 365A and Vagrant's Ordinance. Now, issuing of gender recognition certificate to Register General has been confirmed by the Ministry of Health circular to facilitate the obtaining the birth certificate by changing the biological sex. Men's cell. NCD account for majority of death among men. It is associated with high risk factors like smoking and alcohol with masculine identities. Gender roles of men leads less access to health services. There is no special service provision for men separately. Health issues in people with special needs. They face challenges for both sexes and more common among females. The main problem being the accessing the health knowledge, healthcare services and health communication. Women face forceful sterilization, sexual abuse and gender-based violence. There is no sex disaggregated data among people with special needs. There are no sign language interpreters at hospital set up, even in the national hospital. Mental health. There seem to be gender bias in diagnosis and treatment of mental health condition in men. They are less likely to be diagnosed. The suicide rate is almost twice. Women with mental health condition face maltreatment, abuse by family members, post-institutionalization and post-sterilization are significant. Depression is more common among women. Health research. Women are underrepresented in many researches. Sex disaggregated data is minimal in many research as well as the research publications. Recommendations. All 17 SDG targets should be addressed in parallel way. Strengthening the health policies and guidelines should be addressed to reduce gender inequalities. Restrictive laws should be removed. Indicators of sex disaggregated data should be included into the routine assessment. Research agenda should be in place to identify gender inequalities in health research. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Janaki, for your informative presentation. Over to you, Amanti, to introduce the next speaker.
Thank you, Professor Sampatha. It is my pleasure to introduce the second speaker for this evening, Professor Anuruddhi Edirisingha. Professor Anuruddhi Edirisingha is the Carter Chair Professor of Forensic Medicine in the University of Kelaniya, Sri Lanka. She commenced her career in forensic medicine in the year 2000 and became a board-certified specialist in forensic medicine in 2004. She has over 30 publications in index journals, 2 book chapters, and over 150 presentations at local and international scientific conferences. Her research interests are child abuse, sexual and gender-based violence, homicides, drink driving, unnatural female deaths, etc. Over to you, Professor Anuruddhi.
Thank you, Amanti, for the kind introductions. And my section in this webinar today is on sexual and gender-based violence as a health issue. So let's move. When it comes to violence in many societies, violence has been addressed or responded more as a legal, social or political issue rather than a health issue. In latter part of 80s and early part of 90s, only this has come as a health issue, and the definition of violence drawn by WHO is happened in 1996 at World Health Assembly. Looking at this definition, you can definitely say sustainable development is impossible if there is violence. When it comes to violence, it has three facets, from self-directed to interpersonal to community, to collective violence. And the sexual and gender-based violence definition and the relationship, if you look at the health response part, is the reproductive part, we call it sexual violence, and it is defined by WHO. Whereas if it comes, the violence comes to physical, psychological, and then financial, it becomes broader, and the definition comes from UN. And presently, the gender-based violence is understood as a tree, and if you have a tree, you have roots. So disrespect to human rights, abuse of power, gender inequality, contributed by the bark, from alcohol to violent society to stigma, poverty, lack of education, you name it, everything under the sun. The list can go on more than this. And what you get is leaves and fruit, from verbal abuse to sexual abuse to sexual harassment. And if you have a tree, then it has to be fertilized. My own understanding of the fertilizer is the patriarchal society and the impunity, as well as gender attitudes, which has been explained in the video. When it comes to this issue of violence, any form, whether it's sexual and gender-based or child abuse or any form of violence, we say it follows the phenomenon of iceberg. In iceberg, you can only see one third, and rest two thirds is hidden. And what is surfacing is those who cast health services. And the top tip, which I, as a forensic person, sees the top tip, which are the reported cases from the legal in the criminal justice system. But the underneath, which is not seen, are the structural and the cultural violence, where forced sex and intimate partner is the large group, and the other one, the coerced one, is a considerable number, and the strangers group is quite small, and the same is represented to the tip also. And when it comes to STB with statistics globally, you can see one in three women throughout the world will experience physical and or sexual violence by a partner or nonviolent partner. And Southeast Asia, you can see from this this picture, is the highest. And that's why when it comes to sustainable development goal, this is mainly addressed under gender equality. But the highest form, which is the homicide, the throughout the world, when they develop the homicide statistics, 47% of women homicide victims were intentionally killed by either the intimate partner or the family member, whereas the same phenomenon for men is only 6%. So what are the challenges for Sri Lanka towards development agenda for 2020 when it comes to responding and addressing violence, which we do with the SDG 3 and 5? The issue is so complex, can we compartmentalize it? Sri Lanka, as you know, is a multi-religious, multicultural society with a rich civilization, a Buddhist civilization that underwent a terrorist conflict for 30 years, and the shadows of terrorism still looming. And as Tanki said, our health indices, which are really good, is thanks to free health service and free education. And presently we are categorized as a middle income country. If we are to solve a problem, first of all, I think we should know the depth and the breadth of the problem. And this is the top tip, the sexual violence from the Sri Lanka police, grave crime abstract, the offenses reported to police throughout the past few years. You can see total number of cases are around 2,500 to 2,800. And out of that, the highest, almost half, is in this statutory rape, women under 16 with the consent of the victim. These are the cases which they say mainly the girls eloping with their boyfriend. And significant proportions in the unnatural offenses and grave sexual abuse are again children. And the prevalence rates, the one of the good studies which has been published by Sri Lanka Medical Journal in 2015, where Guruke and Jayasuriya reports based on studies for the for a few years, and they come up with the percentage of 25 to 30%, whereas the most recent study, the Women's Wellbeing Survey 2019, based on again WHO study, they say 20.4% ever partnered women have experienced physical and or sexual violence by an intimate partner in their lifetime. Although the overall percentage is 20%, you can see when it comes to different forms, the psychological is the highest, followed by the physical and the economic. When it comes to research, intimate partner violence research, mainly they are related to living, but the highest form of violence, the suicide and homicide research was lacking. So to fill the gap, researchers from different sectors, from medicine to social science, from the University of Kalania with the Ministry of Health, we conducted a multidisciplinary research using both quantitative and qualitative methods, which was conducted during 2016 and 17 and published to policy documents. And the final understanding is we will be launching in another few months' time. And we did this study covering 5 provinces, and almost the national statistics on homicide we got from the police crime files and the suicides from the ISDs and the JMO. And what were our findings? You can see the suicide incidence rates are coming down, which is really good. And the homicide rates are also quite coming down. And you can see the drastic steep reduction after the LTT defeat. And now we are in again a plateau phase. And for past 5 years, around 450 to 500 homicides occur in Sri Lanka. Out of that, around 25% are female. And when it comes to incident death incidence rates, homicide is 23.6 per million population per year, and our suicide rate is 6 times higher for females. And I think one of the best part of this research was the reasons to die. You can see from this diagram here, 36% are intimate partner violence reported homicide or suicide, and the perpetrator being either the husband, lover, or ex-lover. And 21% of homicide perpetrator was a blood relative. And the most saddest part is 3% of these females who died reported intimate partner violence more than once to the police, and 16% has at least reported once. So you can see the failure of the responding system, and the statistics go more uglier. 15% of victims were raped and murdered, including for children, and 1/5 are coming in the adolescent and the children group, and elderly also another 1/5. I think this narrative, I think the qualitative part of the research really showed us the depth of the issue. And if you look at this narrative from a daughter of a victim from Panamuri, she stated, "My father was a hot-tempered person. I do not know whether the killing was planned at one or as a result of anger, multiple steps of her mother. The mother suffered a lot. I have seen my mother being beaten by the father since my childhood. And this time my mother had to go to the hospital because father has inserted a pole in her vagina and she was bad." You can see the physical abuse getting into the sexual violence and finally culminating as a homicide. And I think this is another much awaited one. What is happening to the judicial process? And I said, this is almost the national figure for that five provinces is 345. We studied 245 and we studied 243 cases. And you can see only 47 has gone up to that time to the Attorney General's department. When it comes to responding to the judicial process, according to the developed world best practices, they say after happening the incident, if the judicial process can complete within 3 years, it is the ideal. So when we analyzed our cohort for that, what we got was only 30% was at the level of high court at that time. So this another narrative again clearly showed that the response of the victims. This is a mother of a victim from Mandur who has to say about the judicial process. "The case is not yet concluded. I am fed up. If God is there, he will be punished in a proper way." So you can see the judicial process in homicide female death showed considerable delays at each step. Many have lost faith in the judicial process due to delays and confirming the notion justice delayed is justice denied. More than the judicial process, I think the effect on family clearly give evidence from the qualitative study. This is again a narrative from a husband of a victim where his own brother killed his wife. He said, "I'm not able to do my job as a carpenter. I sold my machines. My children are still schooling. I cannot look after them properly." You can see husbands becoming helpless and children are looked after by others. Is it due to gender norms? Male being considered as incapable of look after children, or is it as woman's duty? These are the issues, and the complexity is getting more and more if you look at and analyze these narratives. And the gender norms to ignorance, for instance, the latter one where the daughter says about the husband, her mother being killed by multiple stabs by the father. She says, "I do not know why he killed. An astrologer said that somebody has made a curse on us." When it comes to health consequences, we divide the gender-based violence into two, fatal and non-fatal. As a forensic expert, we get involved in this part investigation. But if you look at the non-fatal one, the areas to attend, one single doctor cannot do this. So not only legal medicine, gynecops, pediatrics, STD, psychiatry, family physician, public health, everybody should get together if we are to give a good health response to these people. Health response alone will not solve this issue. You have to come into other sectors as well. So it is multi-sectorial as well, from the investigator security to psychosocial to legal, and finally the greater community all. Over the years, we have been doing quite good initiative from NGOs to women's desks at police stations to Mithur Pierce's in our in our hospitals, to hotlines, to Child Protection Authority and the safe houses, and also developing guidelines. But my concern is here, the latest research again about women's attitude towards gender role is clear. It says many studies, not only this one, even earlier studies, so significant proportion of women themselves are accepting gender stereotype roles and power imbalances. Thus, working towards gender equality as a development goal is challenging. Therefore, best way to address this is through multi-sectoral approach. So, as with Janaki, I'm also concluding as my own ideas of best way to respond. Definitely, we have to improve the policy framework in both addressing both areas, and we have to continue our good work. I personally think without audits and reviews, good work cannot become better or best. And better coordination and reduce impunity and better justice, a big area. I don't have time to talk about it, but I personally believe at least if we do this part, continue public health prevention activities, because prevention is better than cure. So the awareness and the attitude building for better gender ideation is our duty. So I conclude my presentation with this quotation from Francis of Assisi. He said, "Start by doing what is necessary, then do what is possible. Suddenly you are doing impossible." Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Anuruddhi, for that excellent presentation explaining the judiciary process and the whole the problems, right? Thank you so much. So Bihanga, can you please show the next video, please? Thank you, Bihanga. Next, we move on. The next presentation is by Dr. Deepika Artigala. Dr. Deepika Artigala works as a senior health specialist in Colombo office with World Bank South Asia region. She started her career as a national program officer at UNICEF country office Colombo and as a health specialist in Kabul, Afghanistan. She also served as a regional coordinator for South-South Collaboration Program, the UNICEF South Asia region. Deepika is a medical professional specialized in public health. She carries more than 20 years of experience in public health with a vast stronghold of knowledge in managing public health nutrition programs in routine and emergency settings in diversified populations, as well as in reconciliations and development context. She has experience in working in the Ministry of Health Sri Lanka for about 20 years in various capacity at national and district level, managing maternal, newborn and child health programs. Over to you, Deepika.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sampita, for your kind words. Madam Chair, distinguished invitees, ladies and gentlemen, good evening to all of you. Let me share some information on female labor participation in Sri Lanka and also a few thoughts that could be relevant in moving forward. Let me share my slides. This slide shows the female labor force participation rate by country. Higher rates are observed in East Africa, Oceania, Eastern and Western. The lower rates are in North Africa, the Middle East, some parts of Southern Africa and South Asia. Although the South Asia has been undergoing rapid socio-economic transformation, the low female labor force participation is observed. Also, a greater likelihood of women being engaged in unpaid employment is well evident. The situation across the South Asian countries remained largely unchanged. The pattern remains with higher female employment in rural and urban. Agriculture sector accounts for the major portion, although there is a slight change in some countries like Sri Lanka. Women with mid-level education tend to have lower employment rates than those with both lower and higher education. And also the gender employment gap is seen more clearly in middle-age groups. So before I move on to the next slide, let me quickly run through the basic definition. The labor force refers to the total number of people or individuals who are currently employed or in search of jobs. Participation rate is the sum of all workers who are employed or actively seeking employment divided by the total civilian or the working age population. Now let me look at the Sri Lankan situation. The female labor force participation in Sri Lanka has not shown a significant change in recent decades and remains stagnant at a rate of around 30 to 35% of working age women. The latest value from 2019 is 33.5%. The world average in 2019 based on 181 countries is 51.9%. Out of all 181 countries as featured in the ILO stat database, Sri Lanka is ranked 161st and also is ranked in the bottom 15% in the world. Compared to the other South Asian countries, Sri Lanka has a good track record in many human development dimensions, including female survival, education enrollment, and some of the under 5 nutritional indices. Despite of these favorable education and health outcomes of women, Sri Lanka performs poorer than expected on key indicators of women's income earning opportunities and financial inclusion. Women are more likely than men to be unpaid contributing family workers. As for the National Statistics 2020, the estimated labor force economically active population or the labor force in Sri Lanka is about 8.5 million. Out of the economically inactive population, 26% are males and 73% are females. The lowest female participation is observed in urban areas and highest in estate sector. Women make up only around 35% of the labor force in comparison with men's rate is 72%. In addition, women's unemployment rates are more than twice as high as men's. Female unemployment rate is at 9.6%, whereas for male unemployment is at 3.7%. Now let's see this labor force participation, level of education and gender. So unemployment rates are higher than those of males in all levels of education. A worrisome statistic is that the group with the highest education was the most unemployed. This scenario is observed consistently over the past years. The highest unemployment rate is reported from the GCE level and above group, which is about 10%, out of which 5.5% for males and 14.7% for females. It remains a puzzle why Sri Lanka has been unable to translate its high girls' education gains into female labor forced participation. Among the females employed, women predominate in health and education sectors. Underrepresented among private sector employees, 36% versus 44% of employed men. Women clearly continue to be vastly overrepresented among unpaid workers. More than half of working women are employed in the informal sector, which is characterized by, as we all know, the low wages, lack of social protection, and failure to reward workers comparable to the former sector, basically. Share of women among own account workers increased slightly during the past decade. That's a good sign. And also share of women among employers from 9.4% in 2006 to 12.8% for 2015. That is also a positive remark. Women perform much better in professional category, where 64% are women. This is due to high levels of achievement by women in tertiary and professional education. But absence of opportunities for career progression of women workers, even in the strata, they women working is a challenge. Now, in 10 years, the share of females among migrant departures has declined from 52% in 2009 to 31% in 2018. Similarly, the share of female domestic workers among all departures has declined from 46% in 2009 to 31% in 2018. Several policy changes have taken place in late 2013, streamlining the necessary parameters. The earning gap. In Sri Lanka, there are several mechanisms which set wages for different occupations and sectors. According to the 2015 data, the raw earnings gap average across all 9 provinces was 14.9%, with women's average monthly wage being 17,000, roughly Sri Lankan rupees, and men's being 20,000 Sri Lankan rupees. In fact, the raw earnings gap has been steadily shrinking. That is also a positive sign. The gender gap was 19.9% in 2019, compared with 14.9 in 2015. So women may thus be benefiting from the higher labor earnings that helped drive the country's poverty reduction. And also, there's a study done in 2012 using the annual labor force data. In 2012. So that study revealed that the male workers earn between 30 to 36% more than women workers in private sector or semi-government organization. However, the study found that there was a gender parity in earnings in the public sector, which could act as a strong incentive for women to seek public sector employment, irrespective of the less opportunities for promotion and their growth. Research has put forward areas of explanation for low female labor force participation in Sri Lanka. Literature shows that household roles and responsibilities, a mismatch between skills acquired in school and those demanded in the labor market, and also the gender bias and discrimination in labor supply, as well as labor demand dynamics, are some of the key determinants for this poor or low levels of female labor force participation. We know that women's domestic work is not seen as a legitimate contribution to the economic prosperity of the household. Women's influence in domestic decision-making is not only a simple function of their educational achievements and economic power. It has a potential impact on human capital dimensions. Therefore, it is important to make a balance to cater these needs through appropriate policy strategies for better outcome in improving female labor force participation. This is of paramount importance, not only for economic growth, but also for the total human capital development of the nation. Many research reports has found that female workers tend to prefer the types of organizations and jobs that offer flexible hours. They may hold particular locational preferences or prioritizing work from home, which has become a routine in the current pandemic context, or work to a place near to the home, to more, and also to easily combine paid work with household work. So these supply side factors, together with social norms around gender identity, family formation, and mobility, mean that women have limited the range of employment choices and opportunities. These factors cannot be ignored, and this needs to be given due prominence when formulating related policy dialogues. It is evident in many countries that public provision and financing of childcare services as a policy option to promote equity in the access to quality childcare services, and also can potentially boost the economic participation of women. So this will address the socio-physical constraints on women's mobility for job opportunities. Finally, let me conclude. A little less than 2/3 of women are not actively participating in the labor market in Sri Lanka. They are unable to use their economic potential to the fullest. It is apparent that a higher female labor force participation is crucial for the economic development of the country. Recent government economic policy statements have emphasized the need to create an enabling environment for women's participation in the economy to achieve the government's goal of inclusive and balanced development. In the context of post-COVID recovery, renewing efforts to achieving greater female participation in the female labor force and building conditions for equity will be critical to moving toward prosperity. For that, it is time we rethink the role of women at home and at work. Without a dramatic change in attitudes, this cannot be changed. We can support gender equity through labor legislation and creation of a non-discriminatory workplace environment. However, first, gender equality needs to start at home with the way we raise our daughters and sons, creating respectful and caring non-abusive home environment is critical. We women ourselves need to become the drivers of the change that what we want to see. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deepika. Thank you very much, Deepika, for explaining very clearly the contributing factors in labor force participation and about the economic gap and the earning gap. Thank you very much. Amanti, over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Sampatha. I am now happy to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Sepali Kottegoda. Dr. Sepali Kottegoda is an academic and a women's rights activist. She has an MPhil and a DPhil in developmental studies from the IDS University of Sussex, UK. Her BA honours in English literature is from the University of Kelaniya, Sri Lanka. She is a director of programs at the Women and Media Collective, Sri Lanka. Sepali is a visiting lecturer in gender and women's studies at the Faculty of Graduate Studies, University of Colombo. She was a member of the Sri Lanka National Committee on Women and a member of the Sri Lanka Task Force on Prevention of Violence Against Women. Over to you, Sepali.
Thank you very much. Let me share screen. Sorry. I'm screen sharing. Okay, fine. Thank you. Sorry for this hiccup. So I'm picking up from where Dr. Deepika Atikala left off, looking at the another side of women and work and labor on the topic of unpaid care work. So the concept of care is not necessarily associated with work. Care is often conflated with altruism and sacrifice, and very much within the framed within the context of family and the related system of a gender division of labor, where women are seen to play the key role as caregivers. So in mainstream economics, as well as in social perceptions of persons, work is understood as something that brings in an income, remuneration. And as was also explained by the previous speaker, the person has to have a job or be looking for a job. Unpaid care work is because it arises out of social or contractual agreements, like marriage, family, whether it's nuclear or extended, kinship, friendship. And it is care because it comprises a group of activities that serve people in their well-being. And it is work because it is an activity that has costs in terms of time and energy. And this slide shows you a multidimensional picture of work. We have jobs, wages, employment, we have voluntary work, creative expression, writing, dancing, poetry, and we have unpaid care work, which includes water or fur collection, cooking, tending the sick or dependents, washing. I want to bring in some information from Sri Lanka. And I think this is to step into the area of unpaid care work. I'm looking at the census data from 2019, where of the population above 15 years, 16.4, and 8.8 were women and 7.6 were men. And I think the labor force is defined, as was explained, by the economically active population, those who are or were defined as employed or unemployed during the period of the census. There are categories who are not in the labor force, who are categorized as economically inactive. These are persons who neither worked nor were available or looking for work during the reference period. So when we look at the distribution, we are looking at the economically active population, where there's 34% of female and 37.3% of male. And the economically inactive, those who are outside the labor force, 74.8% female and 26.3% male. So the census estimates in 2019 that this out of the 7.8 million, the 73.7 comprises 5.3 women, and 26.3 comprises 2 million males who are economically inactive. Now, the census also tells us why they have been categorized as economically inactive. And it's very clear here, of the total of those in the economically inactive group, 47.2 say they are engaged in housework. And when that is looked at in terms of sex desegregation, 62.4 are female and 4.3 are male. So what does engaged in housework mean? It means engaged in unpaid care work. Most often, these are termed reproductive activities, the food preparation, washing, cleaning, caring for the young, etc. Now these are activities that, if carried out by someone hired for the purpose, would be valued in terms of a wage. And the person who is paid a wage for household care work is counted as being in the labor force and is categorized as being engaged in productive work. I think one of the things also when we look at unpaid care work is enumerating unpaid care work, where I think it's very critical to understand the role that women play in contributing not only to the social and economic well-being of the family, but also to the national economy. If a woman, this is something that was told to me by some women we were having discussions with from different parts of the country. If a woman has a job or is employed, there are times when men or other household members would share some elements of housework because they understood that she was tired after working. But if the woman is a full-time housewife, she's not seen to bring money into the household, and as such, consideration and or support was markedly absent. So assessing the economic contribution of women must necessarily include work that is done for monetary remuneration, as well as work that is done in the reproductive sphere, without which no household would function and no workers would be able to engage in productive work. In relation to valuing care work, there has been much debate and analysis on measuring care work performed in the home. Time use surveys give clear indications of the actual amount of time expended on unpaid care work and valuing this time and work monetarily. But going beyond calculating economic value, we need to also go to policy that support recognizing, reducing, and redistributing unpaid care work. The Department of Census and Statistics did a time use survey. This is the first time they've ever done it in 2017. It was published in 2020. And they had found household activities, in household activities, 76.4% of women who participate will participate in food and meal management and preparation activities such as cooking. And they spend 3 hours per day, approximately. This is 76.4 women. 15.4 men spent 1 hour and 18 minutes on these activities. And the census report notes, considering all Sri Lankans, those who were 10 years and above, the mean population time women spent was 1 hour and 54 minutes, while men spent 12 minutes. Now, the Sustainable Development Goals have gone the furthest to include unpaid care work, which it does in Goal 5, the standalone goal on gender. Yet the complexities of inequalities of power in the reproductive household arena and the productive economic arena needs to be fully grasped if we are to reach Goal 5. The gender gap is the unpaid care work responsibilities also results in a gender gap in participation in paid work. Many women have to withdraw from paid work for long periods to care for family members. As a result, the gender gap in lifetime earnings is even bigger than the pay gap between employed women and men, as many women have no earnings at all for substantial periods of time. And the other factor here is the aging population. In countries like Sri Lanka with aging populations, a growing number of unpaid care work is devoted by women to looking after frail elderly relatives. Public investment in non-medical care services for frail elderly people is low. In Sri Lanka, it is estimated that around 20-25% of the population will be above 60 years of age in the next decade and a half. And it's an important factor for urgent investment in public services to meet the needs of the elderly. It's also an urgent factor for training of medical practitioners and better resourced health services to be prepared to ensure the medical and palliative care for the elderly will be available, as well as increasing public women's labor force participation in paid work. We need to raise the rate of men's participation in unpaid care and domestic work. This requires action from governments, businesses, trade unions, and of course, women's organizations to mobilize resources and change cultures. Thank you. I am now, we will show another short video, which was an outcome. Actually, we have a short video competition, short film competition run by my organization, the Women and Media Collective. And this film was on unpaid care work. So, Vihanga.
කවද්ද
අද උදේ
ගොඩක් අමාරුද
අනේ ඔයාට ඇවිත් යන්න බැරිද
ඒ වුණාට දෙදෙනා ඕකේ
අපේ අම්මා ළිටල කුසී
මල කෙලිය ඉතින්
පංගෙන් එන්නද
තු ළමයි දෙන්න
කොලොකු
එයාගේ නිින්ද ගියා මම කොහෙද ඉති මේ කිලිපිලි සීන් ටික මෙතන හරිද හාල් බෝල් ටික මෙතන බබාගේ කිලි බෝතල් සේරම අතන තියෙනවා එළවලු ටික ෆ්‍රිජ් එකේ සතියම වාගේ යන්නම් ටික පුළුවන් නේ වට තනියම
ඕවතල දලු ඕවා සුදු දේවන්නේ
උදේ 10ට හවස 3ටයි මෙයාට කිලි දෙන්න ඕන සමහර විට මට එන්නත් පුළුවන් වෙයි
हरी हरी वा गील एक बंट एंड को
ताते
अरे 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 मेनू
हेलो
मुकद करानी
वैडा हेलो मैं मुकद
फटा देंड विन्ने ली
अब पढ़ से मुंगे
Vihanga, I will now introduce our last presenter for the day. She is Dr. Nadika Chandaratna. She is a consultant community physician and a senior lecturer at the Department of Community Medicine, Faculty of Medicine, Colombo. She is a member of the Expert Committee on Women's Health and has also served as a secretary to the committee during the period of 2013 to 2016. Over to you. Nadika.
Thank you, madam. So my task today is to summarize what we discussed and introduce you to the factory on facets of gender developed by the Expert Committee on Women's Health, SLMA. As we saw, gender and equity plays a major role in person's health. Gender roles and identities increase the vulnerability and may also lead to poor access to health. Sexual and gender-based violence is a major determinant of ill health among women in our context. So we also saw that even though the educational achievements of Sri Lankan girls are quite high, participation of women in active labor force is very low. One major reason for this low rate is that women are involved in unpaid care work. So if we are to calculate the monetary and economic value of this unpaid care work, it would allow us to realize the role that women play, not only to achieve the well-being of the family, but also towards economic development. While increasing the labor force participation in paid work among women, the rate of men's participation in unpaid care and domestic work also needs to be increased. And some laws which have a direct impact on the health of an individual, for example, the abortion law or the vagrants ordinance, needs to be revisited. And complaints of SJBV and IPV needs to be given serious consideration by everyone, the medical people, the judiciary, and each one of us as responsible citizens. So I would like to conclude mentioning all of us, men and women, do have a role to play in attaining gender equity and contribute toward the development of the country. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Nadika, for that summarizing the whole thing, right, in one fact sheet. Excellent, right? So finally, we have come to the end of our presentation. I would like to thank again the SLMA President Council for all the support given to us in having this webinar tonight. A special thanks goes to Mr. Bihanga, the IT coordinator of SLMA, for all the help given to us to conduct this event smoothly. A big thank you goes to all five speakers who are members of the expert committee in women's health for rising up to this occasion and delivering excellent presentations to educate the audience tonight, and to all members of the Women's Health Committee of the SLMA for all the support given. Finally, I wish to thank all the participants who joined in this webinar from various societies, organizations, and friends. So have a pleasant evening, good night. And I think there are some questions in the chat box. Madam, what should I do?
Any of the things has been answered, Sampata.
All right, okay. Yeah. So thank you. Thank you very much, madam. Do you like to finish it, madam? What? Okay. Thank you very much and have a pleasant evening. Good night.
Thanks. Thank you, Sampata, for a wonderful webinar. I really enjoyed it.
Madam, the credit goes to the whole committee. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.